So I'm back with another episode of the GCN Tech Clinic, where we answer your tech-related problems and questions and queries that you may have. First up though, last week I tackled a question from Parik Furlong, who wanted to fit an 11-speed cassette onto a 10-speed free hub on his Shimano RS80 wheels. I did in fact give a couple of options, but Shimano have actually got back to me with another option, and it was the following. The CSHG800 mountain bike cassette, which is an 11 to 34 ratio. Basically, by using a 34 tooth sprocket, you reduce the chance of any interference between the rear derailleur cage and the spokes. So there you are. However, you're likely, or possibly anyway, gonna need a new rear derailleur for that, because a 34 tooth cassette isn't necessarily compatible with your current rear derailleur. But hey, that's for you, Parik, for you to decide. Right, let's get on with it then, shall we? So, a question from Russ Stark, who says, with most of the braking power up front, why bother with a rear disc? Why not have a disc up front and a direct mount brake in the rear, especially for pros with in-race rear wheel swaps? That's a great question, actually, and I can't answer, obviously, on behalf of the pros, because I'm not one. But I don't even know, maybe it's been tried in the past. What's important to remember, though, is that by using a disc brake, it's not actually for out-and-out power, because that's just going to result in a skid and loss of control. It's actually for modulation, and essentially, it really comes into its own in wet weather and poor conditions, where using a rim brake isn't necessarily the best option. And I think most people who've used disc brakes can agree with that. Now, I think the big stumbling point here will actually be the feel of lever hoods. So a rim brake and a disc brake lever hood are gonna feel different, because there's a reservoir inside of the disc brake hood to obviously hold the oil or fluid. So that's gonna be the biggest challenging point, I imagine, because you don't want to have one feeling different from the other. But it's certainly for one to ask the pros when we meet them next if they would use that option. So I'll keep you posted. Next up is a question from Osman Erdogan, who asks, hi guys, I hope you're well, fit and healthy, so I can't complain. I'm upgrading my bike at the moment from Tiagra 4700 set to an Ultegra 6700 set. Everything is bought apart from the shifters. The question is, can they use a 6700 Ultegra rear derailleur with a 6800 Ultegra shifters? Osman, nice bit of upgrading there. The Ultegra group set is actually a fantastic bit of kit and great value for money. Now, the internal ratchets of the 6800 shifters are different from the 6700. So there's a different amount of lever movement, which in turn changes the amount of cable that's being pulled at the rear derailleur. Unfortunately, you're not going to get spot-on gear shifting there, so you're going to have to match the levers with the mechs in that case, because really you want to be going along with smooth gears, because you're going to enjoy your bike riding more, so make sure it matches. Next up is a question from Kev O'Mealy, who asks, were the teams concerned with tubular tyres that they would come off the rims in extreme heat at the Tour Down Under? Hi Kev, great question. I was actually at the Tour Down Under this year, and I had the sunburn to actually prove that too. I spent quite a bit of time actually there with mechanics, and none of them mentioned any special procedures or really any concerns that any tubulars would come off of the rims. And in fact, it doesn't happen that often anymore. Years ago, we used to see it sometimes in the mountains back in the 80s and 70s, you'd see the odd tubular tyre become dislodged from a rim, probably through a mixture of heavy braking and also the heat. In recent times though, there's a couple for you. 2015, there was a stage of the Tour of Oman, I think it was, where they actually had to cancel a stage because of extreme temperatures. And there was a photo going around of a tubular tyre that actually come away from a rim because of the glue melting. I'm not sure if it was during use or if it was because the wheel was left out in the sun, direct sun obviously on something that's not moving along. Yeah, it's not going to take long really for that to get up to temperature. And then in 2016, I think it was, Wilco Kelderman, he actually had a crash during the Tour de France, and that was caused through melting tubular glue, apparently, And I think it was George Bennett who assisted him with his problem and actually burnt his hand on that hot glue. So there's one for you. I didn't actually hear anything about that. Continental, they actually make a special glue for carbon wheels. So when you're braking on carbon rims, that generates quite a lot of heat, which in turn could possibly melt glue. So they've actually got a special compound of glue, which apparently is better resistant to the heat generated through heavy braking on carbon rims. So there we are. So Sam wants to know, tape or glue for tubs? Right, well, for those of you who don't know, there are two methods of attaching a tubular tyre to a rim. First up, let's talk about tubular tape. So essentially, it's really strong double-sided tape that is applied, first of all, to the rim, and you apply it with loads of pressure. And a little tip here, once I've applied that tape on, I put the tubular on, inflate it to its maximum pressure. That, in turn, forces the tape even more onto the rim. And then basically I go through the whole process of fitting the tubular tyre to the rim. We have actually got a video in the description down below, so you can check out how to do that. Tubular glue, well, the name gives it away. It is a glue and it is specific as well for tyres and rims. Essentially there are different methods. Some people don't like to apply too many layers of glue onto the rim, whereas others like to apply lots and lots. For instance, cyclocross riders, they will put on quite a lot of glue because they don't want that tyre to dislodge from the rim. Reason being, they're using a lot less pressure in the tyres, so there's less pressure being forced onto the rim from the tyre's base tape. So when they go around a corner, they don't want it to fall off. With tape, it could possibly happen. Now, I've used both of them and I've never actually had a tub come off of the rim. For cyclocross though, I've never used tape. There will be people, I'm sure, who have used tape and with great success, and I'm sure they'll let me know in the comments down below. But ultimately, it's up to you. If you're short of time, then go for tape. If you want to do a really good job and make that tyre extra secure, then go for glue. Next up is another tyre question, feeling all rubbery today. This one's from Felix Bacadano, who says, could you do a tutorial on how to fit a tube into a tubeless tyre in case of emergency? Well, this one actually is pretty simple. It's exactly the same as fitting an inner tube to a normal tyre. The only thing is that quite often tubeless tyres are a little bit tougher to actually put over the edge of the rim and put in place. Reason being, because obviously they're a lot more airtight for their intended use of being a tubeless tyre. One thing to also consider is once you've put it in and inflated it, the tyre may not sit exactly right. So if that is the case, just give a little bit of a flex backwards and forwards to actually try and get it to pop into position. And yeah, inflate it to your desired pressure. Personally, I'd probably try and head home because it's quite unlikely, a lot of the time without a CO2 canister, for instance, that you're gonna get that tyre back into its original place, because tubeless tyres can be sometimes a little bit of a pain to fit. Next up is from Tom Govillitz, who asks, hi GCN, I just got a set of Mavic Cosmic Pro SL tubeless wheels. And my question is, if you get a flat, which they did on their first ride after hitting a huge pothole, and the sealant does its job, should I replace the $80 tyre, or did the sealant make a permanent fix? Hi Tom, well, that's a pity, isn't it? On your first ride, you had that happen. I once hit a pothole so hard and deep, I thought I was gonna need a ladder to get out of it. And do you know what? It wrecked the rim, it dented it, and I got a puncture, so that wasn't good. The good news is though, your sealant did its job, but have a good look as well to make sure the tyre isn't damaged from the pothole and also the rim itself, because you may have hit it hard and it might have dented it. Fingers crossed though for you, Tom, you haven't had that happen, but just give it a good inspection. And the good news is you didn't get a puncture. Try Russell, and this is a very regular commenter and also tweeter for GCN Tech. They ask, can non-tubeless ready rims be run with a conversion kit and a tubeless tyre safely? Basically, in my opinion, it's a tough one. It is really, really tough because you have got that conversion kit and it is a tubeless tyre. Basically, I wouldn't use it, I don't think, from my own peace of mind. I've never tried it. There will be people who have, and I'm sure they'll let you know, try Russell, in the comments down below. But I'm afraid I can't answer from first-hand experience if it is safe or not. But if it's not designed for that purpose, personally, I wouldn't go for it. Next up is a question from Can Vural, who asks, should the inner bearings of a BB90 bottom bracket come out really easily? They removed the crank and part of the bottom bracket was stuck to it. They put it back in place, but it's easy to move. Is it supposed to be like that? Okay, right, just to clarify things for everyone at home, the BB90 bottom bracket is a press fit one. So ideally, you're actually gonna need something like this to remove the bearing. So you go from one side of the bottom bracket through and then hit it out with a hammer. Requires quite a bit of force, so it doesn't sound ideal really that your BB90 bearing was able to be removed like that. What's worth remembering though, is that there is actually a V2 bearing available. What's that? It's 0.1 millimeters bigger in diameter than the first edition of the bearing. So pop along to your local shop, get them to have a look inside your bottom bracket to see if there is any other reason why that bearing has come out so easily. If not, sounds like the V2 bearing could be the answer to your problem. Now, Samuel Lundqvist asks, they're thinking about buying a power meter, specifically a stages. Can you, for example, use an old Tegra crank arm on a 105 group set or vice versa? So if they upgrade components later, it'd be nice to be able to use the same power meter. Great question, Sam. And actually, that's a really good option to use because traditionally, power meters used to be on the real high-end scale of pricing. Providing, you know, if you're using the same style of fitting, it's not a problem at all. So you're probably talking about Shimano Holotech 2, so it uses the same fitting type. As far as I'm aware, it doesn't actually change the Q factor. So that's the distance from, if you take a vertical plane through the bottom bracket shell and the distance on both sides to the center of the pedal, doesn't actually change it as far as I'm aware. So importantly, keeping you even and being able to let the power out that you can measure. Daniel Brace. Hello guys, I have stripped the threads on the drive side crank arm. Is there a way of it being salvaged or is it time for a replacement? Daniel, a stripped thread. That is an absolute nightmare in nearly all cases, I think. Now, you haven't said if it's your pedal thread or if it's one that you would use an old school crank puller like this. So that'd be in the center of the crank. You'd screw that in and then wind this handle in to force the crank off the bottom bracket. But let's assume it's your pedal thread. The good news is, Daniel, you can salvage that crank. Essentially, what you do is actually remove that thread with a special tool, and then you insert a bush or a helicoil in there, and that's held in place with glue or really strong Loctite. I can't remember, I've never actually done it myself. I have seen it done. It's kind of a last resort, really. So if it's a very old crank that you can't find a replacement for, then that's certainly an option. Personally, I'd be tempted to have a look around for a secondhand replacement so you can just have a matching pair and you're not going to be using a glued-in pedal thread. Okay, next up, Ben Moore, who asks, they have one gear which they can't use moving from the easiest gear to the next easiest. They have to change gear twice and it jumps a gear. Is it an indexing issue or something else? All changes are smooth. Right, first thing I would do is have a look at where your inner cable goes into the outer cable, so down by the derailleurs most likely, and check to make sure that the cable there is not kinked at all, because if there is, that could be adding a little bit of extra resistance to pull that cable into the outer cable. Another thing to check is that your cables are working nice and smooth so that they're nicely lubricated. Also, check that the cable is clamped in the correct position on the derailleur. I have seen people do it wrong before, leading to misshifts. This one is going to sound a little bit daft, but have a look at your cassette and where the gears are not working right, make sure that the sprocket is actually fitted in the right direction, so the profiling or shifting ramps actually match the other sprockets there. That, well, it's probably quite enough to be getting on with, but finally, check the rear derailleur hanger. So make sure that it is nice and straight, because quite often that can actually plague people with bad gear shifting. Let me know how you get on. Ali Yadzi wants to know, can car gear lube be used as a chain lube? They've seen motorcyclists use it on their chain. Well, Ali, you could, but car lube is pretty thick generally, so it's not going to be ideal for the job. Whereas a bike specific lubricant is nice and thin, so when you apply it very carefully, I must say as well, it can actually get into those rollers and pins and work better. A disadvantage really of that car gear lube is that it's going to be thick, and so thick that it's just going to attract dirt and not work its way into the rollers. Yeah, people have used it in the past, but personally I wouldn't recommend it. I'm quite meticulous about lubing chains, and I reckon our viewers are too, and they will let you know why not to use it, or maybe why to use it, in the comments down below. Final question this week is from Yuri Tolstick, who says, can I use Shimano fishing hooks to pin a race number? For those of you who don't know, Shimano do actually make fishing equipment too. I guess you could, but you may get reeled in quicker if you try a sole breakaway. There we are. Made me laugh anyway. Now do remember as well to let me know your tech questions down there in the comments below, and I'll try and answer them here on the GCN Tech Clinic. Remember as well to like and share this video with your mates, always helps. And also check out the GCN shop, loads of goodies. Now for a video on essential tools for your home workshop, click just down here.